again your personal chapter. So chapter 10, audit and auditors, the last of your company law. Huh. So why should a company appoint auditor? Why auditor? Examine the reports. Huh. Next. Sir, we should be appointed. No, sir. We should also get salaries. That is the first thing. Next come all your examination of report and all. Yeah? Huh. So on a serious note, why? Why should we appoint you? Cheating. Taking some important financial decisions. Huh. What else we'll do? Huh.
We need a sign for filing reports.
All that we need to do is sign, sir. Enough for clearing so much difficult exam. What else we need to do? Yeah? Huh. So auditor is always a watchdog, but not a bloodhound. Yeah, so what is that? Auditor will always try to safeguard the interest of the members and other stakeholders who are in the company. Shareholders, members, stakeholders, it's everyone whom the company is connected with. Government, society, banks, creditors, suppliers, everyone. So all their interests are safeguarded by auditors. So when you sign, it is not only you getting your professional fees, you are representing the interests of all these people. So when you sign, your sign has that value. So stop using it like a autograph, use it like a signature. Yeah, why? Need not mention, every profession has a black mark. So try to reduce that as much as possible. Yeah, because if an auditor is perfect, that company will be perfect. No matter of directors, all that, everything is fine. But if an auditor is good and perfect, every company will be good and perfect. Yeah, it's just that courage and thing it takes you to report it in your audit report. When you stop doing so, that is when the companies will have a downturn. Yes. So that is the main intention of you studying this chapter. Yes, you are appointed. You will provide the first class things, whatever you are appointed for. First class services, all quality services is provided. Everything is fine. Just that once you are acclimatized with the company, you should not stop providing what you are appointed for. Yes. So when a board appoints you, you are not representing the board, but you are representing the stakeholders. Yes. So all the scams, whatever has happened, there has been a little failure of mechanism, but which was again corrected. So the same things has to be undertaken by everyone. Yes. So irrespective of what we do, we have to do it in a perfect way. Message also given. Done. So chapter 10, audit and auditors. Section 139 says, appointment of auditors. Appointment of auditors. So appointment of auditors, if you want, you can do it as a landscape. If it is a landscape, it is good. You can cover everything here. Or you can take it individually, however you feel like. Yeah. So appointment of auditors, There are two things. One is appointment of first auditors as given under section 139 subsection 6. The second one, at first AGM, section 139 subsection 1. First auditor, there are two cases. First one, in the case of government company. I'm just writing it as government company or any other company in which the central government has a weightage, or say state government, or partly by everything comes here only. It is just like government company, so I'm taking as government company. Government company, the other one, any other company. If it's a government company, then within 60 days, so you can write here incorporation. This applies to both. So from the date of incorporation, within 60 days, CAG, who is that? Controller and Auditor General of India, shall appoint first auditors. Within 30 days, if CAG fails to appoint then within 30 days Board of Director shall appoint the first auditor. Board of Directors shall appoint the first auditor. BOD fails, then within next 60 days, members shall appoint. Yes, very simple. Done. In any other company, so company after incorporation, so the first day is same, next within 30 days of incorporation, Board of Directors shall appoint first auditor. If Board fails within next 90 days, members shall appoint. Yes, okay, we'll come here at first AGM. Here again there are two scenarios. First one, the first AGM, should I write after everything? Okay, just write here if you have space. You have space. The auditor appointed. Shall hold office till conclusion of 6th AGM. Appointed by Board of Directors. That is when audit committee is not required. Next one, appointed by audit committee. You can write for both of it, so it is valid. Board of Director or audit committee shall consider following while appointing a auditor. Any order of professional misconduct against auditor or sorry and any proceedings of pending professional misconduct. Yeah, so this is applicable to both, so that is why we are writing in between. Now we'll continue with the left part. So this was a note. So now we are continuing. बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर शल कंसीडर एंड रेकमेंड एन ऑडिटर टू मेंबर इन AGM. That's all here. The other side is where you'll be writing. Audit committee. Audit committee recommends auditor for appointment. To board of directors. Now two possible situations. One is board agrees with whatever they have sent. If board agrees, what happens? It further recommends the name to members for approval at AGM. The problem is when it disagrees with the name suggested by audit committee. So if it disagrees, what happens? When it disagrees, refer back to audit committee for reconsideration citing reasons. So it is not happy with the name recommended, so it sends it back to audit committee for reconsideration. Now it comes back to audit committee again. Now audit committee also has two actions to do. One, so it has two actions. One, does not reconsider and does not reconsider. Both are same, sir. Yes, we'll see why. Now there is a, if at all audit committee considers, what happens? It goes back to same chain again. It reconsiders its request, so it again takes a new name, it again suggests, it is again sent to board, things repeat. So there is no problem. Where is the problem? When it is disagreeing. In disagreeing, there will be ego clashes between auditor committee and board. Now what will happen, we'll see. Now if audit committee does not reconsider and it sends the same report again to the board, now board of director shall also disagree. Ego clash. Yeah. Now ultimately who has the power? Board of director shall record reason for disagreement second one send its own recommendation to members at AGM. So what happens in the other scenario? Board agrees. That time what will happen? Board of director recommends same name to members at AGM. Yes, ego clashes. Oh, were you able to write in landscape? No. In the left part, whatever you have written, just a small note there. Do you have?
Yes, sir. For the first auditor.
First auditor. In the first auditor, just only one point. He shall hold office till conclusion of first AGM. That's all. And if you do not have space, you can write in the next page as a general note. A proposed auditor is common for all, so you can write as general note. Proposed auditor shall submit a certificate that he is eligible for appointment and not disqualified. Proposed appointment is as per the Act. Proposed appointment is within the limit under Act. Details of any proceeding against auditor. Details of proceedings against auditor. Such appointment shall be filed with ROC within 15 days of appointment. Tell me. So, how? Every company shall appoint an auditor as and when on the date of incorporation. There are two types of companies, one government company, any other company. If it's a government company, the auditor will be appointed by a CAG, Comptroller and Auditor General of India. As and when the company is incorporated, within 60 days of incorporation, CAG shall appoint the first auditor of the company. If CAG fails to appoint, the next right goes to the board of directors. Board of directors shall appoint the auditor within 30 days from failure of 60 days. Even if the board fails to appoint, the next right goes to the members. The member shall appoint the auditor within 60 days of failure from the board appoints the auditor. The other case, any other company, very simple, it starts from board. Board of the directors should appoint the auditor within 30 days of incorporation. If the board fails to appoint, the member shall appoint within 90 days of failure of the 30 days. Yeah. So here it is 60, 30, 60. Here it is 30, 90. Yes, do not forget. The next one, the auditor shall be valid for up to first AGM. The moment the conclusion of first AGM happens, the auditor tenure is expired. Now who will be appointed? The other person. Now this person gets expired, the other person should commence it. That person is appointed in first AGM because this person is retiring. Correct? Huh. So in this first AGM, again two cases. How? What is the second one? At first AGM, appointed by board of directors, where there is no requirement of audit committee. The other one, any other case where there is audit committee not appointed in the company. So when the audit committee is appointed, let us see when the audit committee is not appointed. Simple, board will take the name. It will see if there is any proceedings pending against this person. Is he a CA? He'll take the declaration, certificate. He'll see whether the appointment is within the limits. The last note, whatever we have written. What is it within the limits? The maximum number of audits you can take up is up to 20. So, if the number of company you are appointing now, is it within 20? That declaration should be taken by the auditor. He will give a certificate that I am free from all the, no misconduct. I am eligible for appointment. He'll give a certificate that will be taken and they will recommend this name to the members in AGM. Ordinary business, adda, appointment of auditor. Now you will appoint an auditor. Who? The shareholders. Getting the point? Now if it is an audit committee recommends a name to the board of directors. The board of directors, if they agree, that name will further be referred to your members in the AGM. They will appoint it. If at all they disagree, they will send it back to the audit committee to reconsider your recommendation. They will cite the reason why I am not okay with the person you are advising me to appoint. Now, if they agree with whatever board is telling, they will reconsider the name, they will again send it to the board of director. If they find, they will go ahead and they will recommend the name to the members. He will be appointed. If they do not agree with what board is telling, they will either stick on to whatever they are telling and they will send it to board of directors. When they send it to board of directors, there is again two situations. Now, if board of directors agrees that, yes, audit committee convinced me, I can appoint, still it will continue. What? They will recommend it to the members and members will appoint the shareholders, appoint the auditor in the AGM. Now, even if board does not agree with what they want to say, now there is ego clash. Ultimately, it is board who will win. Board will finally recommend their own name to the members, along with the reason why we are not considering the auditor referred by the audit committee. The members will finally pass the resolution. So this is appointment of auditor. Important from exam perspective. You can write a star mark at appointment itself. They can ask you any procedure. Next one, section 139 only, no? No. Now? Now we are okay, sir. 139, 2 and 4. So what is this? So you can, you wrote appointment, no? First was your appointment, now second is your rotation. Rotation of auditors. What do you mean by rotation? He cannot continue after a period of time. So if you are appointed as an auditor, you cannot continue in the same company as an auditor. Why?
Because here the management
will get close. So auditor puts hand on the director, he'll say Maga, then WhatsApp. Yeah, and they'll do all WhatsApp. Yeah. So to avoid that, this Maga Macha relationship, they say after a time, do not continue in the company as an auditor because you are already friends. Yes, that is the reason. Huh. Rotation of auditor.
2 and 4.
Huh. Applicability. Whom does it apply? Rotation, applicability. Yeah, first one, listed company, sir will not see anything else, and company, what company? Unlisted public company having paid up share capital exceeding rupees 100 crore. Next one. Private company paid up share capital exceeding rupees 50 crore. Okay, the first one it is 10 crore. Now it is fine. Third one, all companies except A and B. Who are A and B? The one we just saw, A and B, but having public borrowing from financial institutions or public deposits exceeding rupees 50 crore. Again, limit important from exam perspective. Note OPC and small company are exempt. You can put this topic as important, rotation of auditor. You can put 4 or 5 stars more also. It's important. B, manner of rotation. We saw applicability, that was A. Now manner of rotation. Auditor if he is a individual, how long can you be appointed?
5 years.
Huh? 5 years. 5 individual.
Yes, sir.
Firm?
Yes, sir.
10. Why?
Huh.
Individual maximum tenure shall be 1 term of 5 consecutive years. Not eligible for reappointment for a period of 5 years from completion of tenure. The other side, firm. Maximum of 2 terms of 5 consecutive years on completion of said 2 terms not eligible for reappointment for 5 years. Common note. A firm with common partner shall not be appointed for 5 years. The existing company shall comply with these provisions in their first AGM after 3 years of commencement of this act. So for your reference, you can write that AGM date as 30th 9 2017. The maximum time given to make existing companies comply with the act. So very simple, a listed company, unlisted public company, if it's more than 10 crore capital, if it's private company more than 50 crore paid up share capital, if it's any other company who is not satisfying these two, but you have a borrowings of more than 50 crore or public deposits of more than 50 crore, this rotation of auditor is applicable. What do you mean by rotation of auditor? This maga macha relationship should be avoided. Both of them will become friends. So there are more chances of you failing to perform your duty. So that is the reason they say you have to rotate from becoming an auditor. This year, let you be appointed as auditor. After completion of your tenure, 5 years, there will be a cooling period, up to which you will not be eligible for reappointment in the same company for the next 5 years. After that, sir, you can be reappointed. Yes, if it's a individual, you will be eligible for appointment only for a one term of 5 consecutive years. Sir, can I appoint him for 3 years? Can we appoint him for 3 years? Actually, law says you have to appoint him for 5 consecutive years. Appointment will be valid for 5 years only. Assume you have appointed for 3 years. Can I appoint one more term for 2 years? 3 plus 2. Usually 5, but some mistake happened. You appointed for 3 years. Can you appoint again for 2 years?
Again, it will be for 5 years.
So now you have just appointed for 3 years, no? Can you appoint one more term for 2 years? 3 plus 2. No, that is the reason here the word one term is mandatory. It is one term of 5 consecutive years. If you have not appointed for 5 years, then it is one term. No two terms, that will become second term. Yeah, second one, ideally you cannot appoint an auditor for less than 5 years. It has to be for 5 years. Individual, 5 years. Firm, that is group of people coming as a partnership firm, you are opening up audit firm. Now it has to be 2 terms of 5 consecutive years. Cooling period, in both the cases it is 5 years only. Sir, what is this note common auditor? Assume Deloitte had one partner, yeah, the same partner is auditor in EY also. So first 5 years Deloitte is appointed, again they are only appointed, after that EY is appointed, person is same, no? So they say if you have a common auditor, whatever restriction is available to him is available to you also. Both of you enjoy, you will not be appointed. Yeah, that is what is the meaning of common partner. So if there is a common person in both the audit firms, the same second audit firm can also be not reappointed or appointed. Getting the point? All the existing companies were given 3 years to switch over from the old one to new one. You will see some table and all. What is that table? I think this is done, but still it's okay. Just because it is there, we'll be doing. 2017 is when you have to finally adhere to it. It's already 2020. So, but okay, we'll see. What is it? Assume as on the date of commencement of the act, yeah, you were appointed for 5 or more years. As on the date of appointment, you were appointed for 5 or more years. As on the commencement of the act, when was it commenced? 2013. August, let us take, you were appointed for 5 or more years at that time. Your validity will not be 5 or more years, you will be given only 3 years now. Yes, so whatever you have already completed, I will not ask you, but you will next be valid only for 3 years. Yeah, sir, I was appointed for 4 years, I have still 4 years to go. Your appointment will be 3. That is until the maximum applicability of the act. You were given 3 years time to abide by it. Sir, I was appointed for 3 years. Then? 3 more years? So, it will be 3 more years. It will be 3 years which you have to comply with the act. You were appointed with 2. You were left with 2. Next? 3 years. You are left with 1. 4 years or 3 years?
4.
Why? The maximum tenure, if you see, is coming to 5. Yeah? Here? Is it 6? So, what is technically happening? You have already completed 3 years. So, I have given you a leeway of becoming an auditor for another 3 years. So, that is the reason first 3 cases you are enjoying additional years. The reason is the act has a time limit to be applicable. You cannot just come like this and change your auditor. That is the reason here you were given 3 years. So if at all your tenure is exceeding 5 years, I am giving you maximum of 3 years, irrespective of the tenure you have appointed him. Yeah, in case of audit firm, it will be 10 years. Same, we have seen in the individual perspective, audit firm, it will be 10 years. Getting the point? Got it? This one. This is a very big section. I think your first 12 pages is the same section. Correct? Huh? 16 pages, same section, one section. Your debentures, deposits and all was 16 pages for one chapter. So this is an important one. Why? I don't know if you are able to, guys, this is a very self-respect chapter. Huh? Your institute also takes it personally. You should also take it personally. Yeah. Why? I don't know if you saw it or not. There is already too many limits you are seeing. Too many days. Limits are coming, days are coming. All are important. On an average, 8 to 10 marks will be asked. 8 though for sure. Yeah. So that is the reason I am giving you the time limits very clearly. Casual vacancy of auditor. What do you mean by casual vacancy? Auditor quits. So what are the different types of quitting? Death. Yeah, death, removal, resignation. There are too many ways. But casual vacancy is ideally death or resignation. Yeah. Or any other way, need not be two. In case of company whose audit is done by CAG, that is government company, elaborated and given, other company they can ask you any provision with timelines. Timelines are important. Yeah, within 30 days of casual vacancy, CAG shall fill vacancy if CAG fails within next 30 days board of director shall fill such vacancy. Other company, very simple. What? Within 30 days by board of directors note, if casual vacancy is due to resignation, then within 30 days board of director shall fill vacancy within next 3 months such appointment shall be approved by members Very simple. If at all you are a government company, CAG will have to file whatever the forms are required and they will fill the casual vacancy first if it is a government company. They have to fill it within 30 days. If CAG fails, directors will fill the vacancy. Other company, if it is casual vacancy, any other vacancy other than resignation, board will fill the vacancy. If it is casual vacancy due to resignation, board will fill the vacancy within 3 months. That appointment will be approved by the members. Getting the point? Note, common note. The person appointed in casual vacancy shall be valid till AGM. So whatever is the immediate AGM, till that AGM he will be valid. Why, sir? In the AGM they will again appoint a fresh auditor. If they want they can continue with him only. He should be appointed for 5 years. Getting the point? Yes. So this is just a casual vacancy. That is the reason it is a very minor thing. After that, it will again be appointed in the usual way in your AGM. So these are the main aspects in your section 139. This one is section 139, subsection 8. Clear any doubts in this? I have put all the sections under one heads only. Yeah, wherever you saw bifurcation, that was 4 different sections. Section 140. Under section 140, we have 2 things. Removal of auditor. Before expiry of his term. The other one. Resignation by auditor. Pass board resolution within 30 days. Apply to central government for approval. In form ADT2 within 60 days of approval pass special resolution. In general meeting, so if you want to remove, first pass board resolution, take apply for government's approval. Once a government approves, you have to file, you have to take shareholders' approval now in the form special resolution. Resignation by auditor. Within 30 days auditor shall file statement indicating reasons of such resignation in form ADT3. To be filed with company registrar CAG if government company. When I say government company, the same thing. Central government, partly, partially, and all that part. So there is one more thing. When you are writing 140, what did 140 say? Removal or resignation of an auditor. There was some other section we read. What? In two cases, you have to give special notice. When? We read something called special notice. Which section? 115. Awesome. Resolution with special notice. What is that 115? We saw some case where you have to give special notice. What is that? Removal of? So if you had to appoint an auditor other than retiring auditor, or you pass a resolution that the retiring auditor will not be reappointed, or director appointment, or that removal, 164, or it is one more section which you saw, which one? 140. This is the one. Cross reference, if you remember, section 144, and the other one is not in your syllabus. For now, you'll be seeing a special notice. What is special notice? Nothing. There is a notice given addition to whatever notice will be given. We saw there, if you remember, whenever you are removing an auditor, here you will be giving a special notice again to the members. So what happens here? A special notice, if you remember that day, special notice shall be required when appointing an auditor, a person other than a retiring auditor. That is what we saw. Appointment of an auditor other than a retiring auditor. Did we see? Yes, same thing. On receipt of such a resolution. So when will this happen? So what happens is, if you are completing your term of 5 years, this will not apply. But if you want to be removed in between, assume your validity of appointment is up to 2022-23.
but I want to renew in 2021. I am removing you in between your tenure. Then I have to give a special notice saying that these are the reasons why I am taking you off from as a auditor. Yeah. Now, what happens on receipt of notice? The company shall forthwith send a copy thereof to the retiring auditor saying, we have received a notice from our members saying that they want to remove you from your position as an auditor, and I am keeping you informed. Now, what will he do? He will give his representation. Where notice is given, retiring auditor makes representation in writing. Yeah. Now, he can request the members whatever representation he has made, that can be represented to the members as well. That is, it can be circulated to the members as well. Yeah. If at all it is received too late from the AGM, then the circulation cannot be done. If it is given within time, then he might request for a circulation. Now, once all this is done, if it is fine, then the such resolution will be passed by the members in the meeting. A tribunal can say if at all any auditor is giving this representation without any base or he is abusing the rights as an auditor, then whatever he is telling to circulate it to the members, that will not even be circulated if the tribunal feels so. Getting the point? So this is a special notice. Yeah. So read it with 115 and 144. Special notice important from exam perspective. They can ask you what is special notice. Special notice as per section 115 says that following resolution shall require a special notice to be given to the members. Yeah, that is, a members can give their representation as well if they want to remove a person who is continuing as an auditor. Yeah, so this is a special notice. Power of tribunal to order change of auditor. If tribunal feels fit that this person is not eligible to continue as an auditor because of any of the grounds of misconduct or fraudulent activities or any public interest, either suo motu or on an application made to it by central government or any person concerned, then he shall be removed from a company as an auditor. Yeah. So within 15 days of receipt of such application, tribunal shall pass an order as it deems fit. An auditor, whether individual or firm, against whom that order is passed shall not be eligible to be appointed as an auditor of any company for a period of 5 years. So not this company. You will not be able to be appointed in any company as an auditor if tribunals order so. And from the date of passing order, and auditor shall also be liable for action under section 447. So 5 years no reappointment, another 447, that is section 447 will be imposed. So what happens is, either you will be removed and you will not be eligible for reappointment. Assume you are a firm, you are eligible for two terms. So one term you will be made to finish that, or if it is very grave, you will be removed from that company also. Yeah, that is the instance. Eligibility, qualification and disqualification of an auditor, section 141. So what is the major eligibility? You have to be a chartered accountant. Sir, firm. It has to be a firm of chartered accountants. But do we see people with other categories also in your firm? Yeah. So majority of them should be chartered accountants. You know the point. So they can be appointed as a chartered accountant if you are a CA or majority of the partners are CA. The following person shall not be eligible for appointment as an auditor. Who? A body corporate. So you cannot form a CA firm as a body corporate. That is the reason you will see either a sole proprietor or you will see a partnership firm or a LLP at max. Body company cannot be a auditor. Why? Big four is, who said big four is a company?
They have, like, they say they are company, but they are not working as a company.
Big fours are partnership firms. They are not companies. Yeah, they are established itself as partnership firms. We call them as companies, that's all. All your EY, Deloitte and all are partnership firms. Yeah? Body corporate cannot be. Why? Company has a limited liability. You do some fraud. Satyam, crores, thousands of crores. What is a fraud? I mean, what is the maximum penalty? Up to the company's capital. You form a company. Sir, separate legal entity. Company did the fault, not partners, auditors. You will not be responsible. Getting the point? Nobody corporate. Yeah? An officer or employee of the company cannot be a statutory auditor. A person who is partner or who is in employment of the company cannot be a auditor. What do you mean by that? You are a partnership firm. The partner himself cannot be an auditor. Yeah? A person who is relative or partner and is holding security or interest in the company, subsidiary, associate, holding, then you cannot be appointed as an auditor. Provided relative may hold security or interest in the company of face value not exceeding 1000 rupees. Is it less or more amount? 1000 rupees less amount or more amount? Is it 1 lakh?
1 lakh.
Face value not exceeding 1 lakh? I think I took off zeros. This is 1 lakh rupees. Is this less or more? More only. This is not market value. Face value. Maximum we see is 10 rupees. Yeah. So this will be nothing but 10,000 shares. 10,000 shares into, assume if it is an Infosys company, into 700 rupees. It is a big amount. So it is a big amount. So you can be, if at all they are holding up to 1 lakh rupees of face value. Yeah. Is indebted to the company subsidiary. That is the thing. So if at all, yes, possible. Up to a limit of 1 lakh. So the thing is, the value which the section has prescribed is 1000 rupees. The disqualification says the higher amount is 1 lakh rupees. So the higher amount, that is what is prescribed. That is 1 lakh rupees. Yeah. So you can take down 1 lakh only. So this is 1 lakh rupees, which is a higher amount prescribed by the rules. Indebted is 1 lakh, 5 lakh only. And if there is any person who has given a guarantee, even he cannot come into a relationship, that is as an auditor. A person whose relative is a director or is in the employment of the company as a director or KMP. So a person whose relative is a director or is in the employment of the company as a director or KMP. So my relative is a director or KMP in the company. I cannot be appointed as an auditor. Yeah. If such person or partner is at the date of such appointment or reappointment holding appointment as auditor for more than 20 companies, that limit where he gives you eligibility certificate. This is a certificate. He has to give that I am within my limits. If that is exceeding, then no, you cannot be an auditor. A person who directly or indirectly renders any service referred to in section 144. Even section 144 is important. We'll be seeing that. Yeah. Where a person appointed as an auditor of a company incurs any disqualification, he shall vacate his office as such auditor and such vacation shall be deemed to be casual vacancy. Your question, at the time of employment, what happens if it is a disqualification? He will vacate the office immediately. Remuneration of auditor, what? It will be fixed by members in the general meeting. The remuneration in addition to the fee payable to an auditor include the expenses, if any, incurred by the auditor in connection with the audit. So ideally there is no cap as such, but the remuneration is payable to you as decided by the members in the meeting. Powers of the auditor, what? To access all the books at any given point of time, that is the powers of auditor. Auditor of a holding company can ask for the documents of the subsidiary company as well at any given point of time. That is his power. What is his duty? Duty is to check all the accounts, whether they are in true and fair spirit or not. That's all, sir. That's all. They have just given it in a elaborated way. So saying what? Loans and advances made by the company on the basis of security have been properly secured. So if it is a secured debenture, secured loan, whether the security has been adequately maintained or not, you have to make sure it is your duty to check all this. Yeah. Next one. Whether the transactions of the company which are represented merely by book entries are prejudicial to the interest of the company. So there are only book entries which are made. Is it affecting the company's interest? If yes, make sure that your duty is to check all this. If not, then it is fine. Yeah. Next one. If at all the company sold any of its assets, the assets are not sold at a price less than what they have purchased it for. Why? What if a company buys, say, furniture for 2 lakh rupees and the director buys the furniture from the company for 1 lakh rupees? Who will account it? Getting the point? So anyway, a fraud can happen. So it is your duty to check that also. If at all you have taken an asset, make sure the value is proper. This can happen, right? Happening things only, I'm telling you. I'll tell you one more thing. Assume there should be a difference between company expenses and there should be a difference between company expenses and director's expenses. Correct? Now tell me, board meeting can happen in India or outside India? In India only. There is a catch. General meeting should happen in India. Board meeting can happen anywhere. Anywhere. So directors can go for a holiday saying it is a board meeting. Who stops you? It is happening only. They travel, they say I had a meeting there. It is company's expenses, no? Will the company check, will the auditor check, show me what and all documents you signed there? All he checks is it business expense? What more you can check? Getting the point?
unless and until ethically if the government, the business is not running, you cannot do anything to it. That is a problem.
Huh. Whether the loans and advances made by the company have been shown as deposits. Next one, personal expenses have been charged to revenue account. Make sure that you are telling it to the company. So after everything, the auditor shall report to the members that I have checked, and as on here also they protect your interest. What? See what is the statement say? Accounts examined by him and on every financial statement and to the best of his information and knowledge. If there is something which you didn't check, you will say, sir, that was not in my purview or that was not provided, because even your interest should be safeguarded, or else it becomes your liability, no? Because it is your duty to report and say that there was a fraud. So that is how they will catch hold of you also. Getting the point? The auditor report shall also state he has sought and obtained all the information which were necessary. Proper books of accounts were maintained. The branch office accounts, anything if done by some other auditor, was it sent to the head office or not? And are the details inclusive of the branch office also? Whether the company's balance sheet and P&L account are in agreement with the books of accounts and returns and such other information, whatever he feels. In addition to that, he says what are the observations and comments. The main thing of the audit report. Some wrong has happened, you have to show it as an observation, for which directors gives their reply in the board's report. Yeah. Audit of government company is done by CAG. The auditor so appointed shall submit a copy of audit report to CAG. CAG within 60 days, it can, if it wants, it can conduct two things. One is called as supplementary audit. The other one is called as test audit. What do you mean by supplementary audit and test audit? Huh? Supplementary audit. Supplementary. You have done. If CAG so wants, he will give these documents to another auditor and will tell him, you also check once. That is called a supplementary audit. Test audit. What is test audit? In the report you have given, he will randomly pick something and he will test himself. How do you do test audit? You will check something, sample, and you will do audit. Supplementary, you will give another person to make sure whether whatever the actual auditor has given is correct or not. Getting the difference? So CAG, within 60 days of getting the audit report, he might have conducted supplementary audit or test audit. Yeah. Every auditor shall comply with accounting auditing standards. Section 14 is again important from your exam perspective. Reporting of fraud by auditor. Reporting of fraud by auditor. If fraud involved is rupees 1 crore or more, if less than rupees 1 crore. So what happens? First, auditor within 2 days of knowledge of fraud or irregularity demand or reply from audit committee or board of directors as the case may be. If audit committee is there, then audit committee, if not, board. Need to reply within 45 days to auditor. Within 15 days forward report to central government. That is, central government, that is secretary MCA in sealed cover in post and also email in form ADT4 report. What? Forward his report and reply of audit committee or board. If at all the board or audit committee do not respond at all, he will just forward his report to the government. Yes. If less than 1 crore, auditor within 2 days of knowledge of
fraud or irregularity. Should report amount of fraud involved, parties involved. Company shall disclose details in board's report. What and all they will disclose? All the points mentioned here and D, remedies, remedial action taken. So do you remember the director's report? I told you, remember this is the one. Whatever has been pointed out, director's report has to answer. This is where he will answer. So let me know once done. Very simple. Now what is the duty of an auditor? To conduct audit report and to report fraud. So what happened when the auditor was first appointed? The central government said, you are the best person I can ever believe. Modi said, you are the person I'll ever believe. If at all there is something happening, you quickly call me up. Here is my number. Who said? Modi said. Once you were auditing a company, there was a fraud of 633 rupees. What did you do? You remembered? What did Modi sir say? Modi ji, there is a problem. 643 rupees fraud ho gaya. So Modi sir said, auditor, I understand it is a fraud, but for 643 rupees, why are you calling me? If it is a huge amount, give me a call. Next time you went to an audit and now the money involved was 30 lakh rupees. You called up. It is a huge amount. You called up, Modi ji, one more fraud, 30 lakhs. He said, 30 lakhs is a fraud. It's a big amount for you. Is it a big amount for the nation? Answer is no. So Modi ji went back. He passed a circular. What? Any fraud above 1 crore shall be informed to the central government directly. Any fraud less than 1 crore do not come to me. Why? Sir, are you okay letting go 1 crore rupees? I am not letting it go. You highlight in your audit report. That report will be given to the company for its reply. The company will say, I admit. And what are the remedial actions I have taken? That will be given in your financial statements. AOC 4, MDT 7. It will be filed with this. So any person referring to it, registrar will take an action. Income tax authority will take an action. Any person will take an action. Yeah. Now, if it is more than 1 crore, within 2 days of you getting to know that there is a fraud happening, you have to intimate the company first. See what they have to reply. Wait for 45 days. If they reply with your report and their reply, send it to the government. Who and all? Secretary, MCA, in a sealed cover, and also write an email saying that there is a fraud. Here are the reports. I have said this and the company has also replied. Both put together, send it to him. Sir, what if they have not replied? Wait till 45 days. Immediately after the expiry of 45 days, send your own observation to the secretary and saying that they have not replied. Yeah, they will take the necessary action. This section is applicable to your cost audit and secretarial audit and statutory audit. All three audits, same procedure.